Season. And you know, coming and joining us today in the first session of the Reader's Barrel in conversation with. Today we have Madam Abhirami with us. She will enlighten us all about reading and books. Thank you, ma'am. I would just like to say she's founder of Joy of Books Library in Chennai. She's also a chartered financial analyst and an avid reader. So before starting our session, ma'am, it would be nice if we could know more about your wonderful journey.
Thank you, Monica, for the opportunity. Yes, and a wonderful journey it has been. Being a management graduate also, when I was looking for doing something, you know, getting into a business, and you naturally tend to go towards something that you are very comfortable with and something that you really are passionate about. So our natural progression was towards books. Because I should say we are a family of readers, generations of readers, like everybody in our family on all sides read. So naturally we tended towards a book cafe, I mean a bookstore with cafe, that is the ideal. But then the CFA in me told me that that's probably not a smart choice to do at that point of time. So we decided to go towards a library model, which we have enjoyed thoroughly. It's been 7 years. And it's a beautiful journey. It's really wonderful, and we are enjoying every moment of it. That's a short version of it.
Wow. I mean, really nice generation of readers. Wow, it's so nice to hear that. You know, when you have people around you who are into reading, you know, you have a lot of things to discuss with them then. You get a like-mind kind of thoughts there, and you get involved in good, engaging, like intellectual discussions there. So it's really nice to know that.
Absolutely. A lot of dinner table conversations in our homes are revolving around which authors, who read what, and how each author describes a particular situation and phrases from books and like that. So wow. You're absolutely right on. We have a wonderful value because it's our parents who instilled this by being readers. Just by being readers, they didn't have to force us to read. They were just readers, so we just picked up from where what they were showing us.
Wow, that's beautiful. Constantly surrounded by stories, that's really beautiful. Okay, so ma'am, there is a saying I've heard that, you know, reading is to mind what exercise is to body. Mm-hmm. And you know, this tells that why reading is so important. So I would like that if you could, you know, throw some light on like why reading is important, and you know, how you can, means what is the best way to instill the interest for reading.
If you're looking at instilling reading in a child, I'm assuming that is where you're coming from, like instilling the love for reading in a child.
Yeah.
My first and foremost thing would be, as a parent or as a caregiver, the first attribute that you should have is patience. You know, be patient with the children, because if you're going to be talking to them about books or about reading, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
You have to give them the option of sitting with you and reading. And completely aware of the fact that their attention span is not going to be more than 5 minutes. And you have to accept that. As a parent, or as an adult, let me just put it like that, as an adult in the equation, you have to be completely accepting of the fact that their attention span is not going to be more than 5 minutes.
Okay.
And so yeah, every session shouldn't be like, oh, this 20-minute long, I sit and read with my kid for so long, but then her attention span is so little, it's frustrating. No, understand that this is how much a child will give attention to any activity. And so reading is also another activity. So you can have multiple sessions of reading throughout the day, even for a child as young as 3 months old. We start quite early,
wow.
2 months, 3 months, whenever you can. So even at that point, you just start reading to them those 5 minutes of mm-hmm. reading.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be the first thing I would suggest.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing would be we do have a lot of people come to the library and ask, how do I make my child read?
Yeah.
And the question that we ask is, what do you read?
Yeah, yeah.
How much do you read?
Yeah.
That would be the first question that we will ask parent. So that is where the whole thing is set up, right? I mean, if you're reading and a child is looking at you reading all the time,
mm-hmm.
then it is going to understand that that is a beautiful that is an activity which is worth emulating. Because they all want to copy us, they all want to emulate whatever we are doing. So if you are sitting and reading, they're going to read with you or alongside you. So that is the thing. And the third thing is everybody's journey is different. Just because you at five, at the age of 5 or 6, you are reading certain types of books, do not expect your child to read the same type of books.
Okay.
Because we had certain options,
mm-hmm.
we have a lot of options today. A generation which grew up on Enid Blyton,
mm-hmm.
will not understand the Jerome Sultans of the day.
Yeah.
Right? And we come to the fact that, oh, Enid Blyton's are the best, and the Jerome Sultans are not so good. No, please allow them to explore, allow them to read what they want to.
Mm.
And allow and be there for them. When they want to come and talk to you about those books, be there for them. You know, I have this favorite thing when kids come to the library, I ask them, so what did you read? Do you like this book? And say, yeah, you know what? And they stand and talk for so long
yeah.
about a journal of certain adventure, and it is so beautiful to listen to them. Invest in that time with your child. Be 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and if you are part of that world of theirs, it becomes difficult for them to dismiss you even as they grow up, you know. And as a teen, I'm not sure how many of you have teenage children, so it kind of becomes easy for them to dismiss you when they're older, thinking that mom and dad do not know what they're talking about. But if you invest that time with them, along with them in their reading,
yeah.
then it becomes easier to be there with them.
Okay.
Those will be my few tips to instill the habit of reading in your child.
Okay. Wow. So very beautiful points. I mean, a lot to take from here. And especially I love the idea that, you know, you start reading and because child copies you, imitates you. So, I mean, it is the best way if you want to promote the reading habit in the children. So, very beautiful. Wow.
Yes.
Ma'am, here one question arises, you know, parents, you know, generally ask, like, what is the exact, just write books for the kid, like according to their age, because, you know, parents want that their kid should read, but then again, they don't have that kind of, source or knowledge where they can even, for themselves, you know, they can determine what books to give. So, how you determine the right books for the kid? Is there anything that parents can go for?
Very valid question, everybody is timing you. The options today in children's literature is really good. It's a huge amount of publishers and authors who come up with lovely books. First thing I would suggest is that the basic thing where you turn the page at the end of it, there is a reading age that kind of listed over there, 2 to 4 years, 2 to 6 years and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That could be a guide.
Mm.
Okay, that could be a very rough guide.
Okay.
Ideally, it depends on the child's vocabulary and the child's understanding of the language that you're trying to make the child read in.
Okay.
So if you're looking at, because most of us today are English medium educated children, the children who are doing today are very rarely educated in their mother tongue.
Yeah.
Other than the fact that people speak English at home, leaving aside them, in the subcontinent or in Asian countries, and other places where English is not the first language, even there in India especially, we are primarily teaching them in English.
Yeah.
And so now if you're trying to make them read a book in their mother tongue,
mm-hmm.
then it is going to be difficult, and it's going to be difficult for the child to accept your level. Because just because it says 6 or 7 years old doesn't mean that your child will be equipped to handle the language of a 6-7 year old in that language. Similarly, if the child is not being exposed to the to English, and if you're going to give the child what is appropriate to the age,
mm-hmm.
but not to the appropriateness of the language ability of the child,
mm-hmm.
then the child is going to find it difficult. So it is always good to go with something that you feel that the child will be easily able to read.
Mm-hmm.
You know, will be able to easily read, and then it is okay if the child tells you that, this is easy, I've finished reading this. Mm-hmm. Then there's a sense of achievement for the child, and then you can go on to a level higher. So that will be one way of looking at it. The second thing is to, you know, there are lots of beautiful websites of people who are dedicated to talking about literature and children's literature, what could be appropriate for children of that particular age.
Yeah.
You could use those resources also. And otherwise, let them book, if it's possible. Go ahead and read that. And then you get a handle on the words and then you go about it. But if you want to really improve your language, you need to take relevant books, in the sense that look at books that are going to the stories that you already know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're coming from a Hindi medium, suppose you already know the Ramayana.
Yeah.
Like everybody knows the Ramayana, everybody knows the stories of Jesus. And there are certain knowledge that we already have in whichever language that we have read them.
Yes.
So if you're going to take up that particular story and read it in a new language, then it is easier for you to make sense of what is what is being said. So your contextual learning happens a lot more there.
Okay.
And so that will also be a good way to start reading. The main thing would be to read a lot in whatever language that you choose to become better.
Mm-hmm.
And there are also these comic books, and they do not do not say, oh, they're just comic books.
Yeah.
They're actually treasure drawers. There's so much packed in one panel in each comic, and so it's a beautiful way of understanding what the person is trying to tell.
Mm.
Even without the caption, you just look at the picture and you will be able to understand what they're saying. So when you read the caption, you understand, oh, okay, this is what they're meaning, so this is the context, so I will be able to make sense out of that. So do not dismiss comics. They're really wonderful resources for building up your language and to make beautiful sense of what is happening around.
Yeah.
And Asterix and Tintin. Asterix would be one really good resource for you to enjoy the language. Like basically when I was talking about origin of a particular word, Asterix tops the whole lot. You just pick up one Asterix book and you can just panel by panel you can learn something.
Okay.
Every little thing you can learn something. Just a simple example, like if you look at that, there is a character in Asterix which says White Light Statistics. This is the guy's name. Okay, White Light Statistics will be his name.
Yeah.
And when you're looking at it, it will not mean a whole lot to you. But then if you're looking at it vital statistics, he's the chief of the village.
Mm-hmm.
So he has everybody's he has knowledge about everybody.
Yeah.
So that kind of connects you to the language and what the character is,
mm-hmm.
so that way you will never forget what each role is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what it means in a new language. So Asterix and Obelix, they're just wonderful resources, and you have, and please do not dismiss your children reading Geronimo's Children. Geronimo's Children is a beautiful, beautifully carved book. It's really beautiful. And all the phantoms and whatever we have read as youngsters, they are all relevant. And then please use them more and more to improve your language.
Yeah.
That helps. For people who are from different mediums to English, they really improve a lot.
Okay.
During our time, we had Ren and Martin also.
Yes, Ren and Martin is a grammar resource. I don't think today's children even know about Ren and Martin.
Yes.
Everything is Google and Martin. Google the form. Yeah. Yes.
Yes. Now that is obsolete now.
Yeah.
You know, ma'am, other day we were having a discussion in the book club, you know, the same thing that you raised, this topic of comics, and I remember we all were recalling when we started reading, and you know, many of us came with the answer. I remember at the age of 10, you know, I started reading Tinkle, and I started from there, you know, the curiosity to read
Amar Chitragatha.
Yeah, Amar Chitragatha and Chacha Chaudhary and all those famous comics of, I remember, because when I was 10, these were the famous comics there, Chacha Chaudhary and all the Tinkle and all that. So we can, I can relate to that. You know, from there maybe the interest started. And yes. Yeah.
Apart from that, like we have Tintin also. Tintin and Tintin
Rises. Yes, yes,
yes. Tintin. Yes.
So nowadays also, I believe children must be having a specific set of comics that is, you know, the hype of today. So of course, I would suggest, you know, in your homes, you know, suggest these comics to the children, buy comics for them. You know, there from there, you know, they can start, you know, having that habit of reading. It might interest them, and maybe they will start picking up the books.
Definitely, that's a good suggestion.
Yeah. Okay. And one thing I have heard a lot these days, and even we are doing in our book club as well, the reading challenges is a trend now in the social media. It was there, but now, you know, like everybody is getting to know about it, about the reading challenges. So how do you perceive these challenges? You know, do they really help in, you know, certain kind of imbibing certain reading habits or in some way or the other way? Is it really helpful? Should people, you know, make their own reading challenges?
Absolutely. I think I would suggest that everybody makes a reading challenge for themselves, in the sense that I want to read at least this many genres this year. Whatever. Again, it depends on your reading journey in your life, where you are at, and what you want to do. So yes, a reading challenge is very welcome, because as I constantly keep saying, it only matters that you read.
Yeah.
No. So, however you want to motivate yourself, if you want to become a part of our book club, please be a part of our book club. If you want to become a part of our library, please become a member of the library. If you want to become a reading challenge group, you want to create a reading challenge group, please go ahead, because it is going to motivate you and a few other people who are joining you also. So why not? Ultimately, we are all becoming better. At the end of the year, if you finish the reading challenge or not, you at least attempted to do that.
Yeah.
Even at least attempted to do, even if you finish only 50% of a challenge. Absolutely, why not? You are 50% richer than before.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Beautiful.
So, absolutely welcome the idea of reading challenges.
Wow.
In fact, at the library, we go one step ahead and we say that for every book that you read, you also have to write a review.
Okay.
So, it's going to be like you also put your thoughts down together. So, that way you just don't keep on reading, but you form, you understand, assimilate what is being said, and then bring it out also as a few lines. So that way people who are later taking the books will know, okay, this is a perspective from this particular person. Whether it helps them to pick up the book or not, it's totally up to that person. But then I think they'll know a little bit more.
Sure.
You know, so that way, that is also, I think, is a very effective way of doing it.
Wow.
In fact, everybody can give themselves a small book to write a review. Okay, this year I'm going to do 50 books, and I'm going to write a review for each book, and that will be the most wonderful thing.
Wow, so nice. So we should keep challenging ourselves. The base is that keep challenging yourself. Number doesn't matter. Be it 5, be it 10, 15, 20. It's up to you, your capacity. Try to, you know, go beyond your capacity. I mean, that's the purpose of challenge. When you challenge yourself.
Absolutely, totally, very well.
I heard like recently people are going for audiobooks as well. So is it really affecting the way people are now listening? I mean, because I don't know whether to consider audiobook as a book or not, because we're just listening it. So we're not reading it, we're just listening it. So should we consider it as a book also, or is it like equivalent to reading?
It's a different faculty, right? Reading is a different faculty, and listening is a different faculty. And some people are oral, so they may do better while listening.
Oh yeah.
There are some people, when they take a book, they start to fall asleep right away, and whereas those people might benefit from reading. Why not? I think it's a wonderful effort that people are able to come up with audio books also. And the person who's reading it has to be really good. So otherwise, you will not get the gist of what is being said in the book.
Yeah.
Reading a book is definitely a different experience from listening to a book. It's like listening to a lecture where the difference is that you are listening. So your eyes are not focused on what I've experienced is when your eyes are not focused on what you're doing, your mind wanders everywhere.
Exactly.
So in reading, you can't escape that. You have to look at the book and read. So you are totally into that book. Yes.
No, I actually am listening to more audiobooks this year.
Okay.
And, my last book was Anarchy. And the problem was that was, it was all, facts and everything. So my mind did get wander. But when it came to Emma, I actually enjoyed the book. Whether it was Emma or anything else, I actually enjoyed those audiobooks. But when it comes to these non-fiction books, then I would suggest don't go for audiobooks at all then.
Okay.
And the person also depends, the person who's going to read it out to you, who's going to, whoever's the author, who's going to be the orator, he has his voice, the way he speaks, for it. At least once you should try the audiobooks.
Okay.
Definitely. And as for the kids, currently they have did a wonderful job. They're still doing a wonderful job, I think, where they brought out books, series, and along with music. It is a beautiful way of exploring stories to children who are really young, and children will be sitting through, and once they have graduated from the listening portion, they will get into the books also. So Clarity Tales books were I think one of the very few early adopters of the audio books concept. It is really nice.
Wow.
So for children, I think it really works wonders.
So we should, of course, go for audiobooks. Like, we should try our hands in audiobooks also, try to explore for ourselves what is working. Don't be adamant, just need a physical book. Explore many options, because we really do have many options right nowadays. It's not like earlier days. So I think we should go and explore as many options as possible and see for ourselves.
I think audiobooks will work wonders for people who have to travel a lot.
Yes.
You know, in your everyday morning, if you're commuting to work for an hour or so, I think audiobooks are the best way to go. So you don't have to read while you're moving in the vehicle.
Yeah.
So you can just listen to the book and you'll be able to go. So I think that's really nice. So technology has given us a lot of options today, and I think we should take them all, and we should just better ourselves by knowing more and reading more, whatever.
That's great.
Self-help, there are a lot of self-help books that are available to get out of their spaces, get out of their comfort zones and come out and read. But then they're thinking that reading itself is something that they're not doing. It's just an act of reading that they have to do, then audio files, audio books would be a wonderful way to go. So you can probably give a couple of your executive friends some audio books, and once they start listening to it, and you can probably ask questions and make them part of a book club and ask them to come out of that, and I'm sure they will benefit. That's one thing. The second thing, there are lovely books. One that really comes right away to my mind is Ricardo Semler's 7-Day Weekend. This book really talks a lot about how you can make your life comfortable. I mean, in the sense that there is no set pattern. I mean, you have to, because in this world and in this day and age, there is no separation between work and home life. So you have to create your own space, and you have to make sure that you're able to do it. So books like Ricardo Semler's and the four-hour workday, there's another book like that could also work. And of course, podcasts, as Sumin has said to me, for podcasts are also a great way to bring them out of their comfort zones and talk up, basically get them to come out and look at what they can do. And you have the 4-minute books. There is another one for short book summaries, like 4minutebooks.com. So the books are summarized into just 4 minutes. So people can't have any more excuses than that. They can definitely give 4 minutes of their time to read and become better. And all these books are going to give you a better way to deal with whatever you're doing. And so the stress and everything will definitely come down, and they will get out of their comfort zone, I hope.
About podcasts. Okay. So,
my podcast, I think, that is Suman's chat. I mean, she has suggested that podcasts will do wonders for executives. Like, people are talking about the concepts. It may not be books, as well, but they're talking about concepts, which will also be a great way to go. Audiobooks, podcasts, these are all things that will definitely work for an executive who wants to better themselves and want to come out of their And Suman has also said that Juggernaut app has also about 15 minutes summarization of books. Thank you, Suman. It's a lovely resource. I didn't know about that. So we have a lot of resources today, and I think we can get out of our comfort zones and challenge each other. I mean, challenge people to read this book and make them come out and do things. And I think a lot of companies they're also in, creating book clubs and inviting authors to talk about and having a lot of events like that, which if you're able to participate, you know, get better against it. Wonderful time with so many lovely questions and such wonderful audience. So I think it's been a beautiful thing. What you're doing is really nice. And I really appreciate what the Leaders Battle is doing. And hopefully we'll have more of these with a lot more interesting people.
Yeah.
And
yes.
Also,
if you see, you know, there are a lot of people who are just into English books. Anything related to English literature. People don't really need regional languages. So how, what do you say, you know, what do you want to say to them? And how do you promote regional languages or like, you know, even if it is Hindi language or Tamil language or whatever. Do you have any kind of tips, you know, like, and then many of them know Hindi is too boring. We can't read Hindi books. So how do you tell them to go for it?
My suggestion would be that go for transliterated books. I mean, books that have been the exact books have been transliterated, so you will. The reason why a particular language becomes boring, one of the reasons why a particular language becomes boring is that you don't have enough vocabulary in that language. And the second thing is that you're not comfortable actually reading it. You know, the physical aspect of reading that particular language, you may be talking that language. But for you to read that language and assimilate that information is what is difficult. Right? So if you go for, there are books which are available, if you go for transliterated books, then it will be really nice. That's one way of starting into your culture and language. Other than that, I would suggest that any language or any culture can be assimilated only when you know the language. So you have to really, an Urdu poetry cannot be appreciated without you knowing Urdu. We all get by because thanks to all the great composers and lyricists of the yesteryear that we are all able to appreciate even a little bit of what we hear. Right? So it is actually necessary that you need to immerse yourself in that culture to absorb everything. So again, parents, please promote your mother tongue. As I say, the first 3 years, completely be focused on your mother tongue with the child. The child imbibes a lot of that. At least if the child is able to understand the language that you speak to them, they understand your culture better. Then you don't have to really struggle with a lot of things. So then, you know, English can be easily taught. At any age, English can be easily taught. So it's only going to impose upon later years. So that will be the age when you will have to start. That said, it is very difficult for today's parents to make children learn their mother tongue or any regional language for that matter, because most parents don't know that language. The people who are living in Chennai do not know Tamil to read or write Tamil. They can get by talking colloquially, but it is very difficult to know the language. So it's a very tough question. So to understand the literature, but there is beautiful literature in all the languages, especially in Indian languages. We have beautiful authors, and it's really rich, and we have rich experiences, and those things can come out hopefully in some form in transliterated books. So I think we should look for that, and we hope that somebody makes them all available to everybody.
Yeah.
So,
I agree to you. It is like, you know, to read books in your regional language is difficult. Like currently, this year at least, you have read some Hindi books also. At least I've read Ramcharitmanas proper in Ramki and Hindi as well. And like I'm reading now Vayam Lakshyam. And I generally my reading speed is fine. But now when it comes to Hindi, I'm a bit slow. Because it's quite high and it's too difficult for me to understand. So I'm trying to understand with the way it is written and all that. I'm trying to understand that way. So I think, you know, I also should give a try on the regional languages also. It is important.
Absolutely. And I also find this very difficult when you're reading the history of books, you know, the some words, we don't know the meaning of those words.
Yeah.
Even though it is our language, we don't know what exactly it means. So if you want to go for a dictionary, unfortunately, we don't have a readily accessible dictionary. You know, in this aspect, I think we Google the people who are behind these the online dictionaries, they really do a good job, like, because there are certain societies which give you the respective languages, dictionaries in the digital format. Whereas in print form, you don't find them that easily.
Yeah.
So that way it is quite helpful. But that kind of puts a big break on our reading and, loving the literature more than we are doing right now.
But when you really need to shuffle to different genres, then I think you should go even when challenging yourself to read in your regional language too.
That's a wonderful thing, Kirana.